We are blessed today to sit at the feet of Craig Parton. Craig is a trial lawyer and partner with the oldest law firm in the Western United States, located in Santa Barbara, California. He serves there as chairman of the litigation department. He is former chairman of the litigation section of the Santa Barbara County Bar Association. Upon graduation from college, he spent 7 years on staff with Campus Crusade for Christ, which now goes by the name CRU, the last four of which were spent as national lecturer for Campus Crusade. Mr. Parton traveled to over 100 universities and colleges across the country, defending the Christian faith through lectures and debates. He received his master's degree in Christian apologetics under Dr. John Warwick Montgomery at the Simon Greenleaf School of Law, an institution devoted to the integration of Christian faith and legal reasoning. Mr. Parton then took his Juris Doctorate at the University of California, Hastings Law School in San Francisco, where he served as the executive editor of the Law Journal. Craig Parton is also the United States Director of the International Academy of Apologetics, Evangelism, and Human Rights in Strasbourg, France. Now, you may have had a chance to receive a brochure when you walked in, but if you didn't, when you go in to the reception following the lecture, we'll have those brochures available, and a good opportunity for you to consider maybe attending that your own. I know we have a few alumnus of that very institute who are with us today, who would speak very highly of what they learned at the academy. Craig is also the author of three books, including The Defense Never Rests, A Lawyer Among the Theologians, and Religion on Trial. He has published numerous articles in legal, theological, and cultural journals, including Modern Reformation, Logia, and the Global Journal of Classical Theology. Mr. Parton has contributed articles to numerous published volumes, including Festschrifts for both Professor Dr. John Warwick Montgomery and Professor Dr. Rod Rosenblatt. Join me in welcoming Craig Parton.
Thank you. I assume this is working. I have a complex dealing with technology. I never use overheads, PowerPoint. The last trial that I did recently in Las Vegas, opposing counsel 2 weeks into the trial said, I need to talk to the judge. The judge said, I have something to tell you. And I said, yes, what? He said, none of the jurors have been able to read any of your PowerPoint the last 2 weeks. And that was good for me because I was in the defense on that case. You have an opportunity to go with me on a journey here to talk about two different kinds of people. Now, these are not airtight categories. Everybody kind of bleeds over into one or the other. But there are people that think in terms of facts and evidence. They are tough-minded people, we'll call them. Tough-minded comes from the term used by William James in his book, The Varieties of Religious Experience, done in the early part of last century, and a book by Herbert Feigl on tough-minded people. It is a characteristic of these people that they want evidence, they want to know why you believe what you believe, and they expect you to marshal your case with facts, not with hysteria and not with presuppositions, with evidence, not asking people to assume the truths you are trying to establish, but proving them. I find that a lot of Christians are very good at asking non-Christians to assume the starting point. If you just assume that the Bible is the Word of God, I will show you how Christianity is consistent and true. The only problem with that is, what if somebody has a little brown book called the Bhagavad Gita, and they start with that book, or the Quran, and they start with that book, or the Book of Mormon, or the one I was raised in, Mary Baker Eddy's Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures. If you want to not understand the Scriptures, open up Mary Baker Eddy's Key to the Scriptures. But that's for another talk, another time. So, there are tough-minded people in the world. You all have come across them before, people who want to be interested in what the evidence is. And we're going to do some of that evidence today, the tough-minded case. And frankly, this is easy pickings in Christianity because for 2,000 years, people have been involved in the defense of the Christian faith. dealing with objections that non-Christians raise. We have an overwhelming abundance of evidence, of historical evidence, legal evidences, philosophical evidences based on the traditional proofs for the existence of God, which I will not go into. Otherwise, some of you may fall asleep, the others will leave. I've never found too many people fascinated by the ontological argument for the existence of God, but these arguments are traditionally very strongly presented in Roman Catholic circles and in some Protestant Calvinistic circles. And then there's the scientific evidences, the evidences from intelligent design. So there's a number of ways that the marshaling of evidence can occur for the unbeliever, the skeptic, the person who wants to hear what both sides of the story are. And that's the kind of people that I try to find to speak to. I'm not particularly effective with people who have already made up their mind one way or the other in terms of Christianity. I'm looking for the person who's willing to suspend judgment until they hear what the evidence might be. So we're going to talk about the tough-minded individual, and we're going to find out that the gospel is verified in terms of historical fact. I can establish to you beyond a reasonable doubt that Christianity is true. I can absolutely do that. It's been done by lawyers historically time and time again. Much to your consternation, you know, you've had two lawyers speak here. That means the Lord is returning soon. It doesn't get any worse than when your series is down to a second lawyer. But lawyers have been some of the best advocates for the defense of the Christian faith in history. For over 300 years, lawyers have been involved in the defense of the faith. And they particularly have gone after the resurrection, skeptical lawyers, to see whether the resurrection would stand the test of legal evidence and became Christians as a result. And we'll talk about that. But I want to also today, the second part, probably after the break, I want to talk about Christianity for the artist. There is another component of personality, the person whose interests are in art, music, literature, dance, theater. And it's not that they're antagonistic to evidence. It's just that evidence leaves them less than thrilled, less than fulfilled, less than interested. It's kind of as if they look at you and go, that's fine, that's good that you can prove it, but that's not where I live. I live in the area of film and of music of a high degree, of a high level. And by the way, tomorrow, I don't know if all of you are from this church or not, so since I'm not, I can encourage people to come to this church tomorrow morning for Sunday school and not get in any trouble with my pastor. So tomorrow morning, we're going to talk about an artist who perfectly integrated tough-minded, objective evidence, particularly the revealed word of God, and integrated it with the highest art form in the world today in the area of music. We're going to do that tomorrow morning, 9:30 to 10:30. That was free. It's not free to come. Yes, it is free to come. It is. You're Lutherans, some of you. Lutherans are very sensitive. You're a Baptist. Lutherans are very sensitive to things being free. That's why the books out there have price signs next to them. I've learned over the years doing Lutheran churches that they tend to take books and take no prisoners later. So we're going to talk in the second section about this problem. How do you present an objective apologetic to people for whom objectivity is not a central concern? Don't you dilute the gospel into some liberal Jesus milquetoast approach by trying to subjectively appeal to people on the basis of their inner psychic need. I very much believe that there is an apologetic for these people based on an objective presentation. The gospel is verified on the level of universal psychic need. And we'll see, and not psychic in terms of people who read your palms. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about strong research in different number of different areas that show that people have some universal needs that are pushing them internally, pushing people to the answer that is in the gospel. They suppress that, they deny it when it pops up, but it is appealed to over and over. It's why certain films resonate across cultures. It's why some atheist filmmakers do films that have significant Christ figures in them. They can't help it. There are no defenses to this apologetic that I'll be talking to you after the 3 o'clock hour. Okay, first we want to talk about the tough-minded for a few minutes. Those people who think with their heads, who think in terms of evidence. And we're actually going to be talking a little bit about legal apologetics. At the academy we do in Strasbourg, I do have to do an ad for this because Dr. Montgomery said he would send the mafia to wipe me out if I didn't publicize this. The good news, the academy is going forward in 2016. The bad news, it's full. Next, it is full. The earliest we've ever had it full, it was full in September for 2016. We're going to hold about 4 places for overflow for people, so if you're interested, and we'll put you over to 2017 if that happens. The academy is the only lay apologetics academy for laymen in the world. Several people from this group here have come to the academy. It's where pastors sit next to undergraduates, sit next to a housewife, sit next to a brain surgeon from Singapore, sit next to a Malaysian lawyer, and all have one interest, becoming more solid in talking to people who are unbelievers about the truth of the Christian faith. So anyway, that's what the Academy brochure is. You can check it out on our website, answers all your questions. If you have any, I'll talk to you later. Good, that's done, Dr. Montgomery. If you're watching the video, that's over with. Okay, let's talk about tough-minded apologetics, an approach to present evidence to people who are in a skeptical position. Let me first mention that I'm doing the topic of apologetics, which comes from 1 Peter 3:15. It's a biblical concept. It means to be ready to give a defense. Peter talks about that in Scripture. Be ready always to give a defense for the hope that is within you, yet with gentleness and reverence. That is the perfect balance in the defense of the faith. It's not about winning arguments. It's not about getting scalps from people and checking off that you defeated somebody in an argument. But it's no sign of spirituality to lose an argument either, okay? So the evidence is all in our behalf in terms of the Christian faith. Secularism is really the emperor with no clothing on, and I want to present to you a very simple way to approach the facts of the Christian faith that is Christocentric. Now, the unique aspect of the Academy of Apologetics and what we're going to talk about is I believe apologetics should be Christocentric. I believe that because the apostles teach it. Whenever they are about the defense of the faith, you see in Acts 17 in Mars Hill, it ultimately gets to the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the truth claims of Jesus. Why is this important? Because there are a number of places you can go for apologetics training that will train you in the traditional proofs for the existence of God. They will prove to you through intelligent design that theism is the most rational option. So, if you leave it there, what have you accomplished? Well, not to put it diplomatically, people go to hell as theists. That's what you've accomplished. Unless you push this to a Christocentric position of what this incarnation of Jesus Christ into the world was about, you have left the person in theism. Now, is it sometimes appropriate? That's as far as the discussion likely can go. Absolutely. You need to understand how those traditional arguments for the existence of God and the intelligent design arguments work. You should be adept at those. You should read in those areas. If nothing else that happens today, I'm going to encourage you to read in areas that you wouldn't normally read in. But the fact is that people can have all kinds of crazy reasons why they reject the Christian faith. We need to bring the facts to them simply that push them to face to face with the cross of Jesus Christ. Apologetics is not rationalism. I know in a group like this, I'll say it this way. I don't do Lutheran pastor conferences anymore unless they give me 6 hours. Reason being, after the first hour, they are sure that I'm an Arminian but too stupid to know it. And then the second hour, I'm probably something other than a Lutheran. It takes 6 hours to get to Orthodox. Lutherans can actually be interested in the defense of the faith. And the reason that attracted me personally, and some of you here are not Lutheran, I understand that, neither was I for 20 years. I was a Baptist in Campus Crusade and a number of other things. What attracted me to Lutheran theology was its Christocentric nature. Everything is about Christ and God's revelation in Jesus Christ, and finally, his justification for our sins and Calvary's cross and his resurrection for our justification. So, whatever apologetic you do, it should draw you to focusing on the person and work of Jesus Christ. Otherwise, you leave people in theism, and even the devil is a theist, we're reminded in the book of James. So, we're going to talk about some approaches to a Christocentric apologetic, and we're going to get help from lawyers. Now, in the question-answer session, no free legal advice. None is going to be offered. This is going to be a little discussion about lawyers defending the faith. And I've looked at Montgomery's presentation, and this won't overlap at all. This is some nice little things to remember about the defense of the faith that you can learn from lawyers. First of all, lawyers have been involved in the defense of the faith, as I mentioned, since the 16th century. The first textbook on apologetics was done by a man named Hugo Grotius, who is the father of international law. He was the textbook on it. If you want to learn anything about international law, you read the first textbook on it. And the first textbook on apologetics was written by Grotius in the 16th century, called De Veritate Religionis Christianae, on the truth of the Christian religion. Now that topic, on the truth of the Christian religion, was the title of the next 57 books on apologetics by Christian lawyers. We're not big on creativity, okay? But notice the focus there is on the truth of the Christian religion, not that it feels better by becoming a Christian. It may not. As Dorothy Sayers says, we believe Christianity not because it's the most cheery view of human nature, but because it's truest to the facts of the world. Now that has some gravitas to me. Lawyers have been interested in the defense of the faith consistently for a number of years. Grotius in the 16th century, William Blackstone, the great 18th century common law codifier of the laws of England, was a believing Christian. He was what Abraham Lincoln read in law. Blackstone was used by every law student in this country until the University of Virginia was started by Thomas Jefferson for the avowed purpose, Jefferson said, to get rid of Blackstone. Blackstone was a believing Christian. He said you should start your study of law by studying God's revealed law. And no human law should contradict God's revealed law. Blackstone was an very strong and solid Christian. Then in the 19th century, there was Simon Greenleaf, where I did my apologetics training. Greenleaf was the great professor of evidence at a little place east of here called the Harvard Law School, And Greenleaf did the definitive work on evidence, a three-volume series modestly entitled Greenleaf on Evidence. And when you're Greenleaf, you can title things like that. But Greenleaf was a believing Christian. He actually wrote the Constitution for the nation of Liberia as because of his interest in foreign missions, head of the Massachusetts Bible Society. And Greenleaf wrote the classic work, The Testimony of the Evangelist, which puts Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John on the stand. And that's what we're going to do in just a minute. And that's what I've done in law schools, just got done at the Stanford Law School, talking about the defense of the faith. This is exactly what I tell secularists, people that don't believe in skeptics about Christianity. Put these guys on the witness stand. They cry out to be cross-examined. They're not little once upon a time that happened long, long ago in a country no one can ever check out. Jesus showed up. No. It's specific and detailed exactly who was governor, who was in political power at the time, who his mother and father were, at least his human father, and all kinds of details, stuff that lawyers love to get a hold of. Greenleaf got a hold of that, put Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John on the stand, and vindicated them. So we're going to look a little bit at how lawyers have approached the defense of the faith. Now, a couple things that lawyers are big on. Proof. Proof. They're not big on assumptions. That's why I'm all elbows when I'm with Lutheran theologians. They start with presuppositions, and they build everything in dogmatics, which you should, because the presupposition is the Bible's the Word of God. But the assumption is everybody knows how we got to that assumption, how we got to that principle. But in dealing with people from non-Christian backgrounds, obviously, they're going to have questions about that. And as I mentioned, keep your presuppositions to a minimum. In the law, I cannot ask the jury to assume anything I haven't proven. I have to prove everything unless the court does what's called takes judicial notice of a fact. And those are facts that are beyond dispute. Like Tuesday, September 13th, 1981, was 72 degrees in Santa Barbara at 12 p.m. That's the kind of fact that I can get a court to take judicial notice of, but I'm not going to get judicial notice taken of the fact that Jesus rose from the dead or the Bible's the Word of God. Those are presuppositions of content. Keep your presuppositions of content to a minimum. To a minimum. And prove the maximum. And that's the legal approach. Legal approach is fact-centered. It's aimed at focusing on what the key and central issue is. And the central issue in terms of scriptural revelation is God's presentation of the incarnation of Jesus Christ and his perfect life, atoning death for the sins of the world, and his resurrection for its justification. Lawyers have done this for a long time. They're advocates of the position that you go straight to the center of the case, you present evidence, you minimize the presuppositions. And why have they been so attracted to Christianity? Well, you just start to match this up a little bit. Christianity happens to be fact-centered. Fact-centered. Sometimes if I'm feeling particularly obnoxious, which is regular, I will ask a group, how many of you, and I try to say it as piously as possible, how many of you would still be a Christian if Jesus' body was found? Well, I have news for you, Mrs. Schmatz. Paul wouldn't have been, and nor would any of the apostles. They verified that, or had it, the evidence presented to them, that Christ had resurrected in the flesh from the dead. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, if he's not resurrected, we are the laughingstocks of culture. We ought to be out eating, drinking, and being merry. If Christianity is not true, the option isn't moralism, it's hedonism. And I would get to it as soon as possible. That's 1 Corinthians 15. It is a fact-centered faith. Luke talks about the many infallible proofs in Acts 1:3. This is an evidentiary case. Paul presents it to Festus and Agrippa in Acts 26. At one point, one of them turns to him and says, Paul, if I let you keep going, you will convince me soon to be a Christian. Now, nobody is convinced to be a Christian outside of the work of the Holy Spirit. This is not about abrogating the work of the Holy Spirit to fancy reasons. But the fact is, God doesn't have anything against that appendage that's growing above your neck. A lot of people in Christian circles put high value on the heart relationship with the Lord, and the head was something that he thought twice about after he created it. In fact, we are created whole people, and Christianity appeals to all of us, both mind, body, and soul. It is a full presentation of what Christ has done to redeem us from death. So, Christianity happens to be fact-centered. It has a verifiability criterion. You produce the body of Jesus Christ, and it dissipates, which is why lawyers have focused on the resurrection, and we'll mention that in a moment. And finally, Christianity requires belief. It calls people to believe. Now, we realize nobody can believe without the work of the Holy Spirit. That's theologically, biblically true. But you still have the apostles calling people, believe and you shall be saved. Preaching the gospel, presenting the case for Christianity, and calling people to fiducia, to trust, based on the facts. I believe an affirmative case for Christianity can be made using facts affirmatively, that I can show the best interpretation of those facts is that this man was God in the flesh, died for the sins of the world and rose again for our justification. I believe there is a positive role for apologetics in Christianity, not just a negative role. Negative apologetics are very popular, which basically means you tear apart the other person for an hour. You show them how Mormonism is wrong and how they can't have this and this is wrong and their thinking is marred. I think that's misplaced, and I think it's very dangerous to have a strategy that tears other people apart. If you have 1 hour with a non-Christian, you should spend 55 minutes on the affirmative case for Christianity. And we'll do that in a moment here. 55 minutes and 5 minutes critiquing, tearing up down, noting problems in their position. The reason being, if you refute a person's non-Christian position, that doesn't necessarily establish Christianity as true. The fact that you can take on a cultic person, somebody in Christian Science, for example, and show that Christian Science is historically a fraud, that its teachings harm people, does that mean Christianity is true? No, it means that you've just chalked off another religion. So we've got to give reasons for the non-Christian to consider Christianity. Francis Schaeffer, who is a great friend of the Academy and of Dr. Montgomery's and a wonderful Christian guy, said if he had an hour, he'd spend 55 minutes tearing apart somebody and 5 minutes on the affirmative case. That's the only place we disagreed with Schaeffer on in apologetics. I think that strategically do just the opposite. And you, when people are think they have to defend their own personal view, they get riled up psychologically. It's better to have them grappling with the center of Christianity. As I say irreverently, I would rather lose an argument on the resurrection than win an argument on intelligent design. Okay? That's not very popular sometimes nowadays, but you can win the intelligent design argument in theism and leave a person exactly where they are. So, Christianity pushes people to fiducia. Not just the facts, not just the assent to the facts does not save. Trust in those facts. That is fully, solely, only the work of the Holy Spirit. It is not a self-generated trust that people come up with by pulling themselves up by their own bootstraps. But the facts are what apologetics is built on. The factual case that assent comes to, that people agree to. You see, you can agree that Jesus rose from the dead and be lost eternally. I have books on my shelf by authors that have come to the conclusion that the resurrection actually happened and that Jesus is exactly what he said he was in there and he rose from the dead. And they are not believing Christians. So you can have the facts and you can assent to them, but that doesn't equal saving faith. That fiducia, that trust in those facts is utterly critical biblically. Okay, so how would you go about doing the case for Christianity? First, I assume I have the burden of proof. I don't ask the skeptic, the unbeliever, the person I'm talking to take that burden on them. I have the burden. I'm trying to prove something. I'm that person called the plaintiff. And I don't do a lot of plaintiff's work, but I listen to a lot of good plaintiff's lawyers. And the best plaintiff's lawyers that I've ever dealt with are those that are focused on the central issue to win their case. And they ignore all the other noise out there and stay focused on the central issue they need to win their case. And the burden of proof is absolutely foundational and critical. Okay, how would I go about presenting that case for Christianity? I do it in a very simple way. And again, let me be very clear. You don't start here. You start by presenting the gospel to people. And a lot of people in this day and age have never even heard the gospel. They're kind of in the world of theological Neanderthals now. They don't even know arguments against Christianity. They are shocked to hear that Christianity is about a total rescue. I mean, they've been watching television and they thought it was about being moral or being in the Republican Party or being something other than what the gospel talks about. So there's mass confusion. So you never begin with apologetics. me just be clear on that. You don't go out looking for arguments and telling people, doubtless you have problems with the virgin birth. No, I wouldn't start there. You'll probably end up with a bloody nose if you start into arguments along those lines. You present the gospel to people, and if people believe the gospel and become Christians, you have the opportunity of having something working on the inside on them to confirm all of Christian revelation as you catechize them. So, what are we going to say? How would I build the case for Christianity if I was presenting it as a lawyer to a group, to a non-Christian, and how would I systematically build it up? I do it this way, in four very simple points. Very simple. One, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are primary historical documents. Primary source historical documents. You can get this from Montgomery's History, Law, and Christianity. You can get this from My Religion on Trial, Defense Never Rests, Legal Apologists Out the Wazoo. That first principle, that first line of argumentation is where I find Christians are the weakest, because the rest of it flows pretty easily and directly and strongly from establishing that first principle, that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are primary source documents. So if you've established that, you go to point two. In these reliable documents, Jesus claims to be God in the flesh. In these trustworthy, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, trustworthy. Notice I'm not trying to establish their inerrancy, though I hold to inerrancy, because Jesus did, and he's a decent witness on the topic. If you have a better one, if you've resurrected from the dead, I'm really happy to hear your view of the scripture. But until you do, I'm going to go with him. And he says every jot and tittle is correct, and gave the gift of total recall to the apostles, the apostolic band, not to Joseph Smith, Mary Baker Eddy, or Mother Moses. Okay? He gave it to the apostolic band, and he confirms the Old Testament is exactly as he wanted it to be. So, in this reliable primary source document, reliable, not inerrant, because I don't have to establish inerrancy for this, in this reliable document, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, four records, Jesus claims to be God in human flesh. Now, let's put it this way. This is where most people who have been taught any biblical theology should be having no problem. Verses that establish the deity of Jesus Christ. And this is a free advertisement. You ought to be working with people in catechism class, and kids in junior high. If you're a Baptist or Pentecostal or whatever you are here today, you ought to be training those kids in apologetics in junior high. I don't wait to the adult class at my church. I get them in seventh and eighth grade when their parents don't want them. That's the age, that polemical age, that you want to teach them the verses for the deity of Jesus Christ and examine them publicly in catechesis on those, and the top 10 questions that are asked by non-Christians. Integrate those into the catechetical class that you have. I like to see that revolution occur in churches that have catechetical instruction in junior high, Lutheran Church being one. Okay, there's many verses on this. I like John 8:24. Jesus says, if you don't believe me, you'll die in your sins. Let's face it, nice people don't say things like that. I mean, you've got to have a major complex to go, by the way, I'm speaking here today, and secondly, if you don't believe in me, you will die in your sins. Thank you very much. I'm going back to California. That does not work. There's verses, of course, Luke 5, 18 to 24, the healing of the paralytic, where Jesus not only does the verifiable miracle, but shows that he has power in the unseen area to forgive sins. My son, your sins are forgiven. Take up your pallet and rise. That is the perfect combination of our Lord doing the tangible, verifiable miracle that verified that he had power that was unseen, because you couldn't see the forgiveness of sins happening in front of you. So, second point, in these trustworthy records, Jesus claims to be God in human flesh. We should have that one, no problem. Third, in all four of these records, Jesus' death and resurrection is recorded in great detail. I'm amazed how directly Jesus spoke to the disciples. You read the book of Matthew, he must say it 5 times. He took them aside and told them he was going to suffer and die and be crucified and buried and would rise on the 3rd day. I mean, this isn't some, I'm now going to speak in parables about my death and resurrection. He took them, I can see him shaking them. This is what's going to happen, guys. They didn't get it, they didn't want to get it, but the record's crystal clear. He knew exactly what his mission was. And it's very clear that his resurrection is described in great detail. And his death has already been established by good and competent evidence from the scripture. This man was dead. If you want external evidence for that, go to the American Medical Association's 1972, I believe, 72 or 83, journal article on the physical death of Jesus Christ. I don't like to be saddled to these things because I like to walk around and spit at people. But I guess I have to be. It just doesn't fit my style. Anyway, that article in the AMA journal documents by a physician and 2 others how the death by crucifixion actually matches up exactly with what we understand of first century Roman crucifixion process. This is not the kind of thing you're going to survive. So that's the 3rd point. Get the 1st point, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are reliable primary source documents. Put all your eggs in that basket in terms of learning. Secondly, in these reliable primary source documents, Jesus claims to be in human flesh. Okay, Montgomery makes a big joke about that. You can claim to be anything. It's true. You can claim to be a radish. You can go to a mental health facility and find people that claim to be God all the time. I come from California. We have Druids in Santa Barbara. We have over 200 religions in Santa Barbara. There was a man walking down claiming to be deity the other day wearing a loincloth, and that was it. We don't care much in Santa Barbara what people do, but that one was a little bit odd. But claiming deity, claiming powers, it's easy to claim. Jesus then records in all 4 gospel records, his death and resurrection is described in great detail, and he says it's going to establish his deity and his claims to be able to forgive sin. And 4th, Christ's resurrection proves his deity. His resurrection proves his deity. Okay, some people say at this point, so he rose from the dead. A lot of stuff. I watched some of those super pastors. Most of them are in Dallas, Texas. And they got their hair coiffed real nice like, and they got their nice wife there. And they're talking about some miracles that they do. They raise their dog from the dead. And they, one guy said, yeah, that dog was dead, and I went out to that house on that road, and I rose that dog from the dead. Now, why does that not exactly result in mass changes of church membership and following of that person as the new Christ? Does it kind of strike you that if our Lord would be come to earth to deal with the central issue of human existence, that he probably wouldn't put all the marbles in raising a dog from the dead? Okay, I have nothing against dogs. Okay, I'd be perfectly fine if my dogs are in the eternal life with me. It's wonderful. The Lord loves animals. That's great. But this is a little bit off. If God did become man, what would we want to have as the one issue that he would address? Any, I think, honest thinker would come to the conclusion, if that person could tell me why I die and what happens after I die, that would be grounds for worship. That's the kind of message I would expect an invasion by God in the flesh to result in. Instead, I would not expect Jesus to come to earth to heal hemorrhoids universally, okay, or other profound problems. His resurrection proves his deity. If there's ever a place for worship, this is it. Even the French existentialists argue in a number of their works, in Camus' The Fall and Sartre's No Exit and Beckett's Waiting for Godot and on and on and on, that the primary issue in life is death, and death is irrational, and it may be just as fine to take your own life as it is to do an act. This is the conclusion of sensitive people in literature and has been for over 100 years and longer than that, that you can take your life if there's no answer to the issue of death. So that's the historical argument, very simply. It's based on the reliability of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And I would sell my mother-in-law to get a book that deals with this, and a very good book on it is F.F. Bruce's The New Testament Documents, Are They Reliable? My mother-in-law will not be watching this, so I'll make sure. That I wouldn't sell her for that if I could get like Luther's entire works in German. No. So you get a hold of F.F. Bruce. You get a hold of some of the books that are out there. Religion on Trial deals with this, with the evidence for the reliability of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you establish it. People are shocked. They believe Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were written by inebriated monks in 300 AD because there's a movie about it, okay? And after all, Opie from Andy Griffith did the movie, and he must be a theologian and a historian because he did a movie on Apollo 13, too. And that was pretty historical. So you've got that kind of thinking going on. So the opportunities to spend the time at that first junction, at the very beginning of the discussion, is absolutely critical. And put the time in and put the effort in. So you have that, you have the establish the reliability, Christ claims to be God, verifies it by his resurrection from the dead, the resurrection proves his deity. That is a simple outline. Now, I don't suggest that in dealing with the academically oriented, fact-oriented person, that you sit down and say, I'm now going to go through a four-point outline. That's kind of not how apologetics works. Apologetics works by talking to human beings in every walk of life. And the more you read about the reliability of the New Testament, the more you read about objections raised by non-Christians and equip yourself to deal with them, lo and behold, you will find these people coming across your path. It is uncanny. All of a sudden you start reading in an area because you want to get more depth in it. And what happens? Somebody is sitting next to you on the metro, or somebody is in a classroom with you who has that problem. This is an incredibly practical thing. But apologetics is listening to the objections raised and then bringing the answer and moving that discussion to the cross of Jesus Christ, keeping it Christocentric in nature. That's what effective apologetics is, not leaving people in esoteric discussions about traditional proofs for the existence of God. Okay, that's the historical argument. Not really gone through legal apologetics and how the law would deal with a lot of these things. To suffice to say one thing. When it comes to the resurrection, read lawyers on the resurrection. Read Frank Morrison. Read some of John Montgomery's stuff, History, Law, and Christianity. He is one of the great contemporary defenders of the faith, focusing on the resurrection. It is central. It is central to the case. If the resurrection didn't occur, the bodily resurrection of Jesus, we are most all to be pathetically looked at. So get your information on that, particularly from the legal side of it. There's a book out there called Making the Case. I'd highly recommend you get a hold of that. Now, I want to mention a couple of objections that you're going to get along the way, because things don't always flow so wonderfully when you're in actual discussion with a non-Christian. Non-Christians often bring up Bart Ehrman and all the variant readings there are of the New Testament. How can you believe a book that has 12,500 variants in it, or whatever it might be? It's got hundreds of thousands of changes in it. What do you say to the Bart Ehrmans of the world? Well, couple things you can say. Bart Ehrman's works are usually published in 500,000 copies, by the way. Have you ever found an error in his book? That means if there's just one typo in Bart Ehrman's book and it's been copied 500,000 times, there are 500,000 errors in a book that only has 52,000 words. How could you possibly discern, Bart, what you were intending to do? It must be incredibly inaccurate, your work. What is the problem with that kind of thinking? Here, let me put it this way. Book of Mark has 11,260 Greek words. Okay? If a scribe made one error for every 450 words, he'd have made like 25 to 50 errors in that work. Let's say he misspelled 25 things. And then let's say that copy was copied verbatim by 500 to 1,000 more scribes. You get more errors than there are words in the book of Mark. But remember, you started off with 25 words that are off in the book of Mark out of 12,260. That's only less than 1% of any possibility of having some transcriptional errors in it. 99% of the version you're looking at is absolutely pure, and none of this has any impact on any issue of doctrine or the Christian faith. So this thing has been blown out where all the errors are multiplied on one another, and pretty soon you're thinking, there isn't anything I can get out of accurately out of Scripture at all. That's not the case at all. It is the most reliable work of all antiquity. The problems with biblical scholarship come with the abundance of the copies we have, not with the minimal number of them. For example, in Roman poetry, Catullus in 1st century BC wrote his poetics. The first copy doesn't come until the 14th century. Okay, I have the documentation for this out there in Religion on Trial. 14 centuries later, there's no original ever kept, and yet you can get a master's degree in Catullus at the University of California, Santa Barbara. I know, I've talked to one of the students who's doing that. Now, does anybody ever say, whoa, we have no idea what Catullus ever said. What were those monks doing for 1,400 years? Okay, they were copying scripture. That's probably what they were doing. But they finally got to this, and they got to Catullus's poetry, and they said, this beats a lot of different things. This is pretty good stuff. It's kind of racy, too. I think I'll copy this. And they made three copies before the printing press. And that's all that many of the Latin classics hung on. They hung on a single copy sitting in a jar on a shelf at Oxford College. This isn't my view. This is all documented in Religion on Trial and Defense Never Rests. This is basically basic knowledge in the Latin classics. Many of them, Tacitus and others, were reduced to being one copy on a shelf. And they were discovered and preserved and copied again and again after that. But for a number of years, until the reign of Charlemagne and after, from 9th to 11th centuries, when the copying began in earnest, for hundreds of years, none of this stuff circulated, and the originals were lost. All that to say, if you want to toss the New Testament gospel writers, and I just call them Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, with unbelievers or people that are not Christians, I never call them the gospels, because that assumes what I'm trying to prove. Okay? I call them Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Eyewitnesses or close associates of eyewitnesses. They stand up against the hearsay rule. These are my witnesses. They are at the scene of the crime. John's an eyewitness. Matthew's an eyewitness. Mark, through Peter's, is essentially an eyewitness. Matthew is the kind of bizarre tax gatherer who took notes incredibly. You've got Luke, a physician, doing Acts in the book of Luke. He's doing really messy Greek, but he's a doctor. No. I just wanted to see if you were awake. But Luke is there, he says, accurately writing everything down systematically. And this stuff is circulating amongst hostile witnesses. So even to the extent it's not absolutely eyewitness like John, like Matthew, is within the context of being able to be impeached by hostile witnesses, namely the Romans and the Jewish religious leaders. So it's circulating in that kind of hostility. Okay, now, I'm going to break for your little break. I don't understand why you need a break, but I'm from California, and we're stronger constitutionally than you are. No, as long as you beat the Dodgers, I'm going to be happy no matter what you do. We're going to take a short break, and then we're going to come back, and we're going to change complete directions. We've been talking about a Christianity for the academic, for fact-oriented person, an evidence-oriented person. Now we're going to shift entirely to a person for whom none of this really hit home, the artist, and we'll do that right after the break, okay? What we're going to do now, and I want to give this some time because it's something that we're incredibly weak in apologetics, and it's something that inroads have been made in by John Montgomery before in his book Myth, Allegory, and Gospel. I have a chapter on this at the end of The Defense Never Rests, and it's really part of proposition number 6 in the Tractatus. I know you all have the Tractatus by Montgomery. It's crazy, wild reading. You know, it's the kind of thing that you could watch the Super Bowl, you could read the Tractatus, Super Bowl, watch the Cardinals play in the series, read the Tractatus. But it's really, I've called the Tractatus the apologetical equivalent of the Mass in B minor by Bach. It's the culmination of all his work in apologetics, and his proposition 6 deals with the issue of what we're going to talk about, reaching the higher level tender-minded. Again, let me set this out, what the problem is. Tough-minded, we have all kinds of resources. We have books, we have argumentation, we have 300 years of lawyers' works on the resurrection. There's an abundance of resources for you to deal with hard, tough-minded questions that people will pose to you throughout your life as a Christian believer. We're not very strong when it comes to the arts, and we give the impression that arts of a high level, and I'll talk about this tomorrow, that high culture and Christianity grew in wedlock with one another, and there's a very interesting reason why, but you don't get that till Sunday school, okay? But the cultural expressions of Christianity in music and literature and the arts has been very, very strong historically until recent times, as the rise of popular culture and consumer orientation toward mass media, do it fast, do it without self-reflecting, diversion of attention, all the things that harm art of a high level, which is reflective, which is contemplative, which is deep, which takes discipline, all the things that Bach and Rembrandt and Rouault, for that matter, and all contemporary artists of a high level understand. It's that artist that I'm talking about now. I'm not talking about the lead singer for Led Zeppelin, okay? Just so you know. Not that they won't have artistic interests. I saw a documentary on Mick Jagger of the Rolling Stones recently, and he had a 65th birthday party at his estate in England where he had Bach playing in the garden, okay? The reason being, of course, they understand. They have a stage name, they have a stage presence, but when they want real quality artistic endeavor, they know where to go. Okay, so these people are out there, but I'm talking about art and artists of that kind of level, people that this is not just something to make money on, it's what they would do if they had to eat dirt. They would still do this artistic work. It's just part of who they are. So we have apologetics for what Montgomery calls the tender-minded, individual, and that's what we're going to talk about today. And the term is really an ancient distinction between what are considered to be two cultures. You may have read a book by C.P. Snow called The Two Cultures, the scientist and the humanitarian, the humanities. That there are oftentimes people are predominantly in one camp or the other. And those in the tender-minded camp are often not appealed to by strict, rational, objective evidences. They want, in fact, a cultural and aesthetic expression that fits their highest longings as human beings. And is there a way to present to them an objective apologetic without degenerating into, try this, you'll like it? It seems like these people are only interested in subjectivity, but if we present Christianity as a subjective answer, we've denuded the cross, we've denuded Christianity into something that it is not, is an objective presentation of a rescue of mankind through the cross of Jesus Christ and his resurrection. It seems like this is hopelessly never going to get anywhere. But before you throw up your hands, we are going to look at this through the lens of a couple of different areas, and we're going to start a distance away from Christianity. The point of what I'm saying here is that the gospel is going to be verified through common psychic life, the common psychological pool that all of us draw on, okay? And that common psychic life is pushing toward the Christian answer in all peoples cross-cultural. This is postmodernism's nightmare, because postmodernism believes there are no mega-narratives, there are no overarching stories, everybody is an individual, everybody's appealed to differently. What I'm going to present to you here for just these few minutes suggests that we all understand basic themes, that we understand that there is a fracture that has gone on internally, and that we must be rescued from the outside. Okay, now Montgomery talks about a couple of levels of tender-minded, lower level tender-minded. I'm not going to go into that level. That's the lead singer for the Led Zeppelin and others that aren't interested in the kinds of artistic expression we're going to be talking about here today. I'm talking about the higher level tender-minded person, the aesthetically sensitive person. How can we reach these people without degenerating the gospel into subjectivity? So we're going to begin where the Tractatus and where my final chapter, Defense Never Rests, begins, which is a long ways away from Christian revelation. There were several people that began to look at issues related to the psychological life of people across cultures. We're going to start quite a ways away from Christianity. We're actually going to start with a man named Carl Gustav Jung, J-U-N-G, Jung. Jung was a disciple of Sigmund Freud. He broke with Freud because Freud was a rigid materialist. Freud had limited all psychological phenomenon into materialistic categories. For Freud, there was a life force called the libido that he tried to shove all human psychic explanation into. He later developed a concept of a mortito or death wish. But his point was that Jung found this completely suffocating, that Jung wanted to develop a much more all-embracing explanation for the human psychic life. And Jung actually did this by studying ancient manuscripts. He studied Asian alchemical manuscripts, medieval manuscripts. He did psychoanalytic dream interpretations with Zurich businessmen. He had a wide, broad reach of people that he actually either studied or treated himself directly. And for Jung, he called these basic expressions that he discovered, these basic psychological forms, he called archetypes. He said there are archetypes of the collective unconscious. Now, what did he mean by that? Archetypes are universal forms, universal images, themes that come up across cultures, no matter if they're pagan cultures, tribal cultures, advanced cultures, these symbols come up. And he called them archetypes or fundamental types of the collective unconscious. It's not a single person came up with these. There's dream images that are universal in certain situations that Jung talked about. And he called them these archetypal symbols of the collective unconscious. What are they? What kinds of things are they? Well, there's the symbol of the old man with a beard, okay? Kind of the Father Santa Claus figure. And Santa Claus ends up being cross-cultural. I don't know if you knew that, but this the concept of a being from outside our situation who is all-loving and benevolent and wants to give gifts is not restricted to Noel. It is not restricted to Western culture. That theme bubbles up in the psychic lives of people, Jung said, and it's a father image, indeed. Then there's the image of the wicked witch, usually some kind of nasty lady, fangs and stuff. No, it's not nice person. but that person usually associated with introducing evil into a situation. And then there's prince and princesses who are involved in rescuing the situation or have made fatal decisions to lend their culture, send their culture down along a certain line. These archetypes symbolize certain basic themes. And what I'm trying to make the point here, this is the point. Jung said there are certain images that are associated with man's recognition that he is fractured. Man, said Jung, is trying to, he called it, conjoin opposites, that he recognizes that he's fractured, and much of his psychological life is trying to mend that together, to mend that together. And one of the symbols that Jung discovered through his reading cross-culturally, a symbol of the conjunction of opposites, was the cross. The cross. And the cross, as you may or may not know, is not restricted only to Christianity. The caduceus in medical circles, the cross with the two serpents on it, you may think that came from John 3 and Moses raising up the serpent and Jesus as Moses was lifted up, so the Son of Man will be lifted up. There's not necessarily a connection between Christian theology and the caduceus of Greek medical science. These things have cross-cultural applications. And Jung said, this is the kind of stuff that you find cross-culturally. And the cross symbolizes an answer to man's opposites needing to be conjoined. So here is one link to this collective unconscious. It's people like Carl Gustav Jung in his book, Man and His Symbols, okay? And the psychoanalytic theory of analysis. And I don't do psychoanalytic theory, nor am I the son of a psychoanalytic theorist. So I won't analyze you and won't get into any more detail on it, but just to note that this is one element of research being done to determine that people intuitively understand that they need a redemption. They are broken people. Well, also you can look at in the area of religious phenomenology. And Montgomery in Tractatus in Proposition 6 looks at it, and I look at it in Defense Never Rests, in the work of Mircea Eliade, a Hungarian sociologist, who was doing the same thing as Jung was doing, but he was looking at religions. Why do religions get started? What is the sociology behind a religion? Why do religions get started? Why do they? What are they trying to do? And Eliade found the same thing. Religions are formed to try and deal with people's fracturedness. And they're trying to give them an answer for why they are in the situation they are in. Says Eliade, describing this situation, Eliade says, at the beginning and the end of religious history for man, we find the same yearning for paradise. It's much of Eliade's works. If we take into account the fact that yearning for paradise is equally discernible in all general religions of the world, we have the right to assume the mystical memory of a blessedness without history haunts man from the moment he becomes aware of his situation in the cosmos. Basically, he's saying cultures have this idea of a bliss before it got messed up. There's some recognition, and the concept of a flood narrative is in many different cultures. Now, some of you are getting nervous at this point because you think we're now going to degenerate Christianity into some kind of life force. We're not going to do anything of the sort. Christianity is where all of this gets fulfilled, and it's historical, and we'll see that in a moment. But those of you that are getting nervous, I could tell you were getting nervous. I thought I'd mention that there's hope coming. Okay? Just make it through Mircea Eliade in his book, The Myth of the Eternal Return. He says the formative ideas of religions are exactly what Jung is saying also, that this stuff is, even in primitive cultures, these religions are looking to conjoin opposites. They're looking to give people cosmic healing of what they understand is their fractured situation. And then finally, in the area of folklore, there's tremendous work that was done a number of decades ago. In fact, the motif index to folk literature was developed in the 1950s at University of Indiana. And that index takes stories cross-culturally and ties them together, where you find elves and dwarves and witches and old men and nasty princes and princesses and all that, and ties these together so that you can read cross-culturally in Asian studies, in Korea, in Indian studies, of certain primary themes and functions that you will find in folk literature. And folk literature ends up saying much of the same thing that Jung is saying in Man and His Symbols and Eliot is saying in Religious Phenomenology. What are they saying? Well, Montgomery, in Mythallegory and Gospel, puts it this way. He calls it the story of Sleeping Beauty. The story of Sleeping Beauty is not restricted to Western culture. This concept that there is a prophecy given that a princess is going to be lured, or a ruler of a kingdom is going to be lured into an error. It's going to be tempted by a witch, by a serpent, by something evil is going to tempt that person, and a complete cosmic death is going to descend upon that castle, that culture, whatever it may be. And nobody can prevent this death from occurring. Nobody can stop this. There is no rescue going to come internally until a prince enters the situation and gives the princess the kiss of love, and they awaken, she awakens, life comes back to the castle, the brambles grow again, and they have a marriage supper and all live happily ever after. Now, does that sound vaguely familiar? And it should. It's an approaching of the gospel story. It's, in one sense, it is producing in folk literature like this a pointing to the answer that there needs to be a complete rescue from the outside. It needs to be a rescue that we cannot achieve on our own. Well, what if there were a group of Christian artists who understood this issue? What if they were able to produce works of art, not because they read Jung and Eliot and read folk tales, but they understood that there are certain formative archetypal things going on in every human being that are appealed to by these certain images? And what if they produced, for example, literature that used these images? This would be a way to test whether what I'm saying is accurate or not. It's a way to test whether this stuff gets to non-Christians or doesn't. And in fact, there has been a growing group of literary authors that have endeavored to work, sometimes consciously, sometimes not so consciously, to produce literature like this. In particular, the Inklings and C.S. Lewis and J.R.R. Tolkien, but Charles Williams, Dorothy Sayers, and others, some of the other authors that we'll mention in a moment. But these people, Lewis in particular, in his allegorical work, The Chronicles of Narnia, puts these themes into place. And what happens when non-Christians read this material? They don't have defenses to it that they have to your rational apologetics. They understand, sometimes with anger, if you give them the Chronicles of Narnia to their early reading child to read stories to them, that you have imported a Trojan horse into the home. And the Trojan horse is the Chronicles of Narnia because the whole family loves the stories, the strength of the stories, but these archetypal images are being used so that even a sensitive child at the moment where Aslan puts his life down for Edward, a sensitive child, even a non-Christian parent, will weep at that, because of the important psychological impact that has. Again, this is confirmation that this material is working at a deeper level than sheer rationality. But it's working at an objective level. It's connecting, and Lewis directly connected up Aslan, the work of Christ, because it was allegory. It wasn't deep myth. That's something you took the brilliance of Tolkien to do. Tolkien did such a monumental work in The Lord of the Rings that it's staggering in the implications that it has. It's not allegorical. You can't line up Gandalf with God the Father. You can at times, other times not exactly. But there's not this perfect one-to-one connection in his deep myth works. But again, these images are there, and people are absolutely overwhelmed by Tolkien mythology. And much of it is supportive of being tamped down with biblical revelation and objective apologetics, because many of these inklings wrote tough-minded apologetics also, along with the tender-minded. So you can, if you have exposure to this kind of literature, you can make people aware of it. And when the question comes, oh, then the gospel's just like another myth, right? Then you realize the person has shifted from a tender-minded objection to Christianity to a tough-minded objection. And then you have all the tough-minded answers that come from apologetics to answer the question that it was just myth. No, when Caesar Augustus was reigning, a census went out that everyone should be taxed. Licinius was governor of Syria. You've got all this factual information in Scripture that connects it up to really happening and not just being some kind of mythological situation. Lewis puts it this way in Christian Reflections. I was by now too experienced in literary criticism to regard the Gospels as myths. I love that. I mean, he realized he was being brought in through the mythical world of George MacDonald into the Christian gospel. He's very clear on that in Surprised by Joy. His entree into Christianity was mythical literature done by George MacDonald, and he couldn't stop the train that got going when he started reading this. They had not the mythical taste, and yet the very matter which they set down in their artless, historical fashion, those narrow, unattractive Jews, too blind to the mythical wealth of the pagan world around them, was precisely the matter of the great myths. If ever a myth had become fact, had been incarnated, it would be just like this. Myths were like it in one way, histories were like it in another, but nothing was simply like it, and no person was like the person it depicted, as real and recognizable as the depth of time. That's Jesus Christ. So, Tolkien follows up on this in his essay on fairy tales and understood that this stuff was working on these kinds of levels, but it wasn't like Tolkien and Lewis and the Inklings got around each other and Tolkien said, how can I make Gandalf more like God the Father so people become Christians? It doesn't work like that. Myth doesn't work like that. It works as a great story. These stories connect to people because they're human beings. That's why they connect. And Tolkien says the following. The Gospels, he said, contain a story of a larger kind which embrace all the essence of fairy tales. They contain many marvels, peculiarly artistic, beautiful, and moving, mythical in their perfect self-contained significance, and at the same time, powerfully symbolic and allegorical. And among the marvels is the greatest and most complete conceivable eucatastrophe, or great event. The birth of Christ is the eucatastrophe, or perfect event of man's history. The resurrection is the eucatastrophe of the story of the incarnation. The story begins and ends in joy. It has preeminently the inner consistency of reality. He says at one point, the Christian joy, the Gloria, is of the same kind and is preeminently, if not infinitely, high and joyous. This story in the gospel is supreme and it is true. And it is true. Art has been verified. God is the Lord of angels and of men and of elves. Legend and history have met and fused. What we're suggesting is when you have authors of this kind of brilliance and profundity writing this kind of material, that you become familiar with it in the literary setting for people that are interested in this kind of thing. You can move this literature in their direction. And you will find that people, the basic biblical themes that come out, particularly in the allegorical works of Lewis, can then be used as springboards to talk about the fact that this really happened in one day. This is his historical reference and can be of tremendous value and usefulness to them in that situation in general. So you have Jung doing the work in psychoanalytic theory. You have Mircea Eliade in religious phenomenology, looking at how religions, why they start and what they're saying. And you have Stith Thompson in folk literature, all being tamped down by these works of the Inklings, and Dorothy Sayers included. But there are contemporary authors that are attempting to do some of the same thing, some of them not very successfully. So whenever somebody says, well, have you read so-and-so? It's usually Frank Peretti or something. I say, you know, why don't you read C.S. Lewis and J.R.R. Tolkien for a while? And because they have already gotten the reputation of incredible brilliance as storytellers. So, point being, there is an objective presentation that can come through higher level artistic works to the tender-minded. It has to be tamped down. It can't be left in ethereal realms. All we're saying is that people's psychic life is much more common than society wants to tell us. It wants to constantly tell us we're all unique, you're different, there's no meta-narratives in postmodernism. This is not the case. The case is people are going nuts. They want to vote for Gandalf for president some years ago. Why? There's a sign out, support your local hobbit. Why are this going on? Because people intuitively recognize that they wish the world was run by Gandalf. They wish the world had hobbits in it. That's the imaginative world that these people can get lost in. And then to move these people from that realm to the facticity of the gospel. And tomorrow, and then we'll break for questions now, tomorrow we'll look at a musical artist who did this at the greatest level of profundity that's ever been done, J.S. Bach. Okay, you have questions you want to bring up, down?
Yes.
Gosh, you guys are looking like you're the mafia or something, walking up here. Vito, I'm going to take care of the audience now. Okay.
We have had a couple of questions already come in on email, and I appreciate both of these because they're exceedingly practical, so building
Good.
Off of what you okay. have set for us. Here's the first one. Craig, you mentioned that the first step in apologetics is sharing the gospel with people. What role do you play in evangelism in your local congregation, and what advice do you have for those, especially lay people, looking to engage in evangelism, and then, if necessary, apologetics?
Yeah, I'm president of my congregation. The average age is 105. We use TLH, and there was a universal, I did not insist the new hymnal be used. I'm tired of being catered to as a baby boomer generation. I can't wait till my generation dies. So I've got faithful people that are ministered to through TLH, and that's not going to change. We don't have an evangelism committee. I hate to say this. This is not, and I don't mean to run my stick on anybody's fence, but I was in evangelicalism for 25 years. We never had an evangelism committee. We just evangelized. Lutherans have committees. They have to have committees. They have to be organized, and then they all get around. They go, where are the materials we're going to use? Did CPH publish them, put their imprimatur neo obstat on them? If they didn't, Mr. Parton, we're not going to use those materials again because they could be... I know you didn't want to get this answer, but the fact of the matter is the kinds of stuff you get in apologetics and at the academy, you won't ask the question about how much you evangelize anymore. It'll be in the... just the nature of what you do and every day where you operate in your vocation. I operate in my vocation as a trial lawyer. I say to people, I operate a confessional in my office because of the attorney-client privilege. But I get to evangelize all the time. I can't imagine people in the bad situations that I have them in my office not needing some rescue from the outside. And it's just a natural situation. And evangelicals, we have a lot to learn from when it comes to evangelism. They naturally talk to people about Jesus Christ. Lutherans are often, and getting better on this, but they are completely quagmired in this, because there's some view that apologetics is kind of like preaching. I mean, it's within the domain of preaching, and I didn't go to the seminary. Let's see, pastor did go to the seminary. If anybody's going to do apologetics, going to be pastor, because if I mess up the gospel, think of the bad things that happen. But if I bring them to church, and pastor messes up the gospel, and it's on pastor. So I don't have an evangelism committee at our church. The evangelism that we do is go to the rest homes and bring the gospel to people who are dying. That's one of our main evangelism things. So I don't know if anybody really wanted that answer, but that's the answer. Yeah.
It looks like Fred wants to build on that, so.
Thank you, Craig. As a musician, I play out in the community, coffee houses, bars, things like that. And I have found that sooner or later, they find out that I'm a minister as well as a musician. And I've often heard confession over a bottle of beer at a, yeah. And granted, you know, absolution as well yeah. as the interchange. But what I wanted to say is I've found that relationships that develop, and sometimes it takes 10 years, not 10 minutes,
yeah.
to develop a kind of relationship with an unbelieving person that enables them to ask the question that is really on their heart,
yeah.
which is, you've got light in your life. I'm in darkness. How do I get there?
Yeah.
And so I just wanted to emphasize relationships.
Good point,
in this.
Fred. Good point. And by the way, I'd like to rent the collar. I would love to have a clerical collar. I think those are the absolute... I mean, if I was a pastor, I'd wear that thing all the time. I would. Think of the people that would come up to you and say, I've got had a tragedy. A pastor, pray for me. I mean, talk about what an opportunity. I would... Can I have the collar, Fred? The other thing is, I'll just add this. I take this however you're going to take it. I don't find anybody has been attracted to the gospel because of my life at all. I have found that people are open to talking with me because I am realistic about being a sinner. And I am a beggar who has found where to get bread. That I find non-Christians are listening to. If I give any impression that I actually am in a rarefied state up here, and I've had professional acquaintances in my firm in the past that played their piety very big and heavy to people, and it doesn't go well. The Lord doesn't like to share that with people. And I just encourage you, be realistic. You know, the more I talk about the struggles I have, that I'm just like them, and have found redemption in Jesus Christ and a total rescue, then I find people willing to talk. But the more I divide myself off and say, you know, I really have this wonderful life, about that time your neighbor says, was that you swearing the other day over there? Yeah, sorry about that.
All right, another very practical question. With the advent of social media applications like Facebook, many people discuss various topics while never actually having a face-to-face discussion. While this is certainly not the best environment to discuss such important topics on a personal level, to what extent should we use social media to engage those who post blatantly false information? For example, conspiracy theories that Jesus was made up by Roman government officials to control the populace.
Yeah, I don't do Facebook, I don't do LinkedIn. I define my life by what I don't do. And I read serious stuff. I have several journals that I belong to, and my view is if the person isn't willing to get published, I'm not going to respond to them. Okay, that's on one level. Should we use every medium to get the gospel out to people that have questions? Absolutely. The blogger stuff is your world. I've never responded to a blog in my life. God willing, I never will. just because it's people bleh, with no self-reflection and no editor saying, that was really profoundly stupid and illogical and has been better expressed by Bart Ehrman or Michael Martin or Bertrand Russell or a bunch of other atheists than you, and I'm not going to waste my time trying to answer it now for the 17th time. Get a hold of the book by Nicholas Carr, The Shallows, which talks about how our brain is being rewired with the internet and with the diversions created by that. I'm finding people less and less able to follow argumentation, and it's a serious issue. It's a serious issue. I'm not a complete Luddite. That is, I mean, I would like to be a monk, frankly. I'd like to live in the 16th century if they had anesthesia. And I would want to be put in southern France in Chateauneuf-du-Pape so I could drink good wine constantly. But other than that, I cannot fathom what's going on in this generation that is diverted constantly with quick answers. But this is the opportunity we have to show that we are the church of depth, of contemplation, of real answers to real needs people have. And people are responding to it. I could give you some illustrations, but people may watch this video who are part of that illustration, of people that are very much caught up in popular culture, who are seeing that Christianity is the depth they've always wanted. Their psychic life, their artistic life has been pointing in this direction. They just want to find that when they become into the Christian church that they're not crushed for being an artist or crushed for being a musician or a writer, and looking for some help along those lines. Anyway.
All right, another question. It seems that in the aftermath of Star Wars, 1977, our cultural desire for mythology has exploded. Is this a fair observation? And if so, what is it about our materialistic culture that seems to cry out for the deep mythology that is manifest in the gospel?
Yeah, I think that's a very serious insight. And I do think this kind of science fiction mythology thing on a very superficial level, you can see all kinds of illustrations of it poorly done. Oh, what about Harry Potter? Have you read what the author of Harry Potter said about Tolkien? So basically, if you read Tolkien, don't read me. She gets it. It's like Mick Jagger. If you're doing Bach, understand, I'm just a performance. That's all I am. I'm popular culture, I package it, and it's out to you, because I know you're going to eat this up on a very certain level. Tolkien's doing something on a much deeper depth level. So yes, the materialistic culture is oriented that way as it pushes people to look inward, and we're having a stronger focus on that, I see, across the board with Eastern religions, not talking about being an Eastern religion, but bringing their forms of spiritual practice into the church, where people are turning to focus inward. And that has got its own world of hurt coming, a real world of hurt coming, because the gospel is an external answer. It's a rescue. It tells you when you look inside, you find how dirty and black it really is. And the answer is outside of you. So I do think there's been an explosion of these things, but I don't think we've seen the kind of high art expressions that that sensitive filmmakers and authors and theater folks can do. And when it is done, it stands out like a sore thumb. Anyway.
All right. Another question. This one was submitted as a handwritten question. Why did Christ's death have to be so torturous?
Why did he have to die at all? Why is it bread and wine? Why is it, I mean, I have a whole list of things that I would have done differently, but apparently I was not consulted. I'm serious. If I would have been in charge of this thing, there would have been a whole different way of doing this. I would have just announced the forgiveness and forget the suffering. But that doesn't take into account the nature of the fall and the nature of our rebellion. If you read Genesis 1, 2, and 3 seriously, this is a cosmic rebellion. This is a fracture at the most basic level that took the death of God's only Son to redeem us. And I'm not in a good place to criticize the suffering the Lord went through. Beats me why it had to be so bloody. I have some suggestions from Isaiah that it was for our iniquities, and I have a feeling I kind of know how black mine are. That's as far as I go, as far as I go. The rest is just speculation as to why. But it's an all-sufficient sacrifice, and for me, that's the significance.
And we might even point out that the physiological reality of crucifixion was the lesser part of Christ's suffering that he endured on Good Friday. The greater part was simply the abandonment by his Father, right, and therefore suffering the pangs of hell itself as right, the weight of sin is upon him.
Right, yeah, right. Yeah. And, you know, one apologetical point from that is the suffering of Christ for the sins of the world. The fact that Christian hospitals have the crucifix in them. I would still looking for the first Buddhist hospital to have a crucifix or a suffering Buddha on it. I mean, the whole point of Buddhism is to transcend suffering. Christianity understands it, and the incarnate Christ took that suffering of the world on himself. So you see Catholic hospitals with the crucifix there. And it's the basis that Christ took on our humanity. That incarnation is the basis for Halloween, all artistic endeavor. We're going to find out tomorrow when you all come to Sunday school. It does. That was Bach's understanding. Incarnational theology of the Lutheran Reformation pushed him to do the work he did. Without Luther, no Bach. No Bach. That was absolutely established. He was a serious theologian, and it was incarnationally oriented. It was God becoming man that said, you know what? You can do a cantata. You can do French dances. You can drink and smoke. You have freedom as a Christian. You have liberty to do it, but do it to the best of your ability and use your discipline for the honor and glory of Christ and his kingdom. I'm preaching now. That felt really good.
I agree. Now, speaking of tomorrow's Bible class, somebody did ask, for those with other obligations, will the Sunday school class be taped? We will make our best effort. I'm not going to make a 100% guarantee, but we'll certainly try to make that happen, an audio record of that. All right, another question. You said that you came to Lutheranism.
Boy, there's no live questions, you know? That tells you what's happened in multimedia days. Maybe it just puts them in by texting.
We have a live one over here.
All right. Well,
I like live questions.
Out. Yes. Okay, a live question.
Good. With all the talk of ISIS and the criticism about that, a lot of young people say, well, how about in the Old Testament, all the killing that God allowed for people? How do you justify or explain
I didn't catch
that?
All the killing going on with ISIS, and how does it?
Well, they'll say, well, how about in the Old Testament when God allowed all the, yeah, you know, told people to wipe out?
Yeah.
Know,
it's a serious question. It's a very good question. Why did God allow that to happen? You know, again, I think if we've got to bring ourselves to understand what the purpose of the Old Testament was. Purpose was to preserve the messianic line, to get a savior that would come to save the world from its sins and die on Calvary's cross and resurrect for our justification. Sometimes that required the Lord to do some radical cancer surgery on his people and people who his people were around. Because every time they got close to him, it was inevitable. The prophets are like the example of this. You've got compromise and you've got Israel going off whoring after false gods in 10 minutes. So sometimes it took radical cancer surgery to deal with that. And let alone the kind of practices that some of these cultures were going involved in that were not exactly like they were all sweetness and light. And so I would, you know, note that in responses to people that talk about the tough sayings of the Old Testament. Actually, the toughest sayings about hell are in the New Testament from our Lord's mouth. That's where the tough stuff comes. The Old Testament has some of the greatest gospel passages of forgiveness. I'll take you back. You've wandered away. the Isaiah 65, 1 and 2 passages, the iniquities have come between us, you know, I want you back. This kind of, it's so clear from Old Testament theology that God was keeping, preserving his people for the revelation of his son that was promised in the garden after the fall.
Since Craig prefers live questions, I'm going to have Stan bring the mic to Ross Johnson, right there to your right. Ross, ask the question that you emailed to me.
Oh. Uh-oh. Hold it. Let me check this.
Well,
that's not what you said.
All right. That question actually was my wife. She was using it. I don't know what it is.
Give the mic to Maria.
But I do have a question. You've been doing evangelism and apologetics for many decades. When you started versus today's student generation, how has apologetics changed? How has the mindset of the student in today changed versus a few decades ago?
Excellent question. I think the concept we've moved from modernism, which at least believed that Christianity was false, okay? Modernism believed that Christianity could be disproven and was false. David Hume, rationalists of the 18th century, the French deists, all these, that Christianity was untrue and could be proven to be so. Now, you get the response on campus, I'm really glad for you. It's great that you found that truth. There's no concept of that logically you can't hold these things at the same time, that not everything everybody believes can be true for them. So I'm finding much more work needs to be done in epistemology, that is the theory of knowledge, how you know what you know and what that means in evangelism. And it's very difficult for people to see that Christianity claims to be true, and where it is true and exclusive, all other religions must be false on that point. I mean, be clear, it doesn't mean all religions and everything they teach is false. That's not what Christianity requires us to hold. Where they contradict John 14, 6 and other exclusive passages, they are false, necessarily. But, you know, Buddhism, love your neighbor, I understand that. But the issues in dealing with contemporary apologetics are really issues of epistemology. You get this kind of ho-hum, that's for you. I'm glad that you found it to be true, but it's not for me. I have my own truth. Every religion teaches a variety of things. There's no right, there's no wrong, that's your interpretation. All that stuff we dealt with on the DVDs, but let me tell you, that's not the way the world works. It's not my perception of reality. If you want to know that, sir, I'll take you out. Let's walk to the corner, a bus is coming. Do you think a bus is coming? Because I don't, I'm going to push you in front of it. That breaks down. Postmodernism only works in very self-contained worlds like literary criticism. It doesn't work for cancer doctors. I represent a cancer center in Santa Barbara area, a number of different doctors there. They give objective diagnoses. Now, they might be wrong, but they believe they're correct in their diagnosis. You don't get postmodern cancer doctors. You know, in my world, you've got a tumor, but in many other worlds, there wouldn't be a tumor there. So you do what you want to do, you know? And same in the law. The law is not postmodern. Juries come to a verdict based on evidence. So I try to help students that are blocked into this mindset that truth is relative and it can be everything for everyone. So you don't live that way. Because if you did, why don't you eat this concrete right now instead of the foie gras that is waiting here for you? That's a French delicacy, by the way. Point that out.
Now, the ever so profound, more profound question asked by Ross's wife, Maria, that came in on was, you said that you came to Lutheranism because of its Christocentricity. Can you explain what you mean by that?
Yes, the gospel was central and focus of all apologetics that I was being taught by Montgomery and by Rod Rosenblatt. I had spent 7 years on staff with Campus Crusade, over 100 campuses, 150 campuses, speaking in classrooms, dealing with apologetics, being around the best evangelical apologists that there were, and I learned a tremendous amount. But it took the focus of Montgomery and Rosenblatt, and it struck me that everything was linked back to the cross, to the centrality of the incarnation, death and perfect life, and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And I asked them 20 years before ending up in a Lutheran church. So those of you who aren't Lutheran, this is not an evangelical, you're going to walk the aisle to become a Lutheran. I'm just telling you what happened. 20 years before it happened, I asked them what church they went to. They said, why do you want to know? I said, because this stuff is so Christocentric, I'd like to find a church that puts the cross at the center of everything they do and brings us back to sin and redemption and the work of Christ, the resurrection. And they mentioned this church, Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, and I thought, that's my luck. I have to go to Missouri to find it. Seriously, I did. And they said, well, start reading these things. And I read Luther's Small Catechism. I read Walther's Long Gospel. I read Luther. I read Chemnitz's of the Lord's Supper. I read tons of Lutheran theology. And it just, I read my way, humanly speaking, read my way into Lutheranism over time, where the worship world that I was in was in tension with that Christocentric nature of Lutheran theology. And I finally said, you know what? We are so desperate. We are at the bottom of the bottom. I'm going to actually try a Lutheran church. That's how bad it is. Because Lutherans are liberal and they're Catholic, but they're too dumb to know either. That's what I figured. And that's how you're perceived, by the way, by evangelicals. You are liberal because your pastor has a collar and you have symbols, let's just say, that you're liberal, and you're Catholic. And once I got over the fact that this thing was Christocentric and everything had a biblical reason for being done in the worship service, it pushed the apologetics and the worship life conjoined with what I was already doing apologetically. I was teaching Luther's Small Catechism to classes bigger than this in Baptist church at home for 15 years. And they loved it. They thought I was the most brilliant theologian they had ever heard. And then we get to the sacraments, and I'd say, well, I'm going to teach some things that I don't think are correct, but frankly, Eastern Orthodoxy, Roman Catholicism, and Lutheranism appear to agree on the real presence of Christ in the sacraments. They have some distinctions there, but we're the kind of new to the game with the ceremonial thing. So, as far as I can see, Luther's got all the verses, and the downside of becoming a Lutheran is you get more at the Lord's Supper rather than less. So I think I'm going to make that choice and take that risk with it. And we don't know what the riches that we have, which drives me to drink. No, that's a good thing. it drives me crazy to see the churches that don't honor that heritage and treasure that they have. Yeah, yeah, you had a question.
Yeah.
I can hear you. Yes.
Do you think we're on the verge of an uptick in Christianity? The opportunity?
That's a good question. In light of all the persecutions and other things, are we looking at an uptick? What I can say is we've never seen more interest. Let me put it this way. I gauge this a couple of different ways. At the Academy in Strasbourg, we never had a Lutheran for 10 years. Okay? For 10 years, it was all Baptists and Pentecostals. Why? Because they do evangelism. They talk like crazy. They evangelize anything that breathes. You've been around a Baptist? Give me a good Bible-believing Baptist any day. They evangelize everything that breathes. For 10 years, no Lutherans. Last year, half a dozen LCMS-ordained pastors came to Strasbourg. And a number of different laymen. Probably 80% of the entire academy was Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. So I can say in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, there is a recognition that secularism is not going to sit down and let you just worship. They are not going to do this. And you are going to make some very difficult decisions as time goes on. And I think it's having a very salutary effect on people. People that are kind of on the sidelines are going to be realizing if they say things or take a stand, they may end up in real trouble. And I say bring it. Bring it. I have a chapter in Defense Never Rests on the church in, as 21st century Rome again. This is like Rome, okay? This is like there is no institutional advantage to Christianity anymore. This isn't after Constantine. This is a fight. this is a fight, and this is where people are going to need to evangelize their neighbor, or we're going to suffer the consequences. Lord only knows what my grandchildren are going to have to deal with in terms of persecution. Shame on the church, though, for keeping its mouth shut. That was for free. Yeah.
In this context, and also back to Ross's question, we realized here at Village of 5 or 6, 7 years ago, we came to the realization that there were no LCMS campus ministries taking place in the metropolitan area. Can you speak to how LCMS and Lutherans can, what you think, having been in the campus for many years, should be doing and how we could organize?
I'll pay you later for that question. No campus ministry, and we're losing the culture. Uh-huh. Figure that one out. I mean, here's what I would do. Okay? I would take every graduate from St. Louis and Fort Wayne for 10 years. Instead of sending them to Cow Butt, Nebraska, I would send them to the dorms of the freshman dorms of the top 25 colleges in America. And I'd have them evangelize every freshman around. Freshman year, you lose more of your kids to atheism and secularism the first semester in college. This room couldn't hold the number of parents that I've had weeping over what happens to their kids in college the first year. We should be going after this. We should be doing evangelism and campus ministry, supporting it wholeheartedly. And the LCMS is starting to do some things on that.
And so is Village, by the way.
Yeah,
so.
And Village. That is couldn't be more. I mean, think of the freshmen that are out there who don't know what to believe, and they're away from home for the first time, and a lot of them are never heard the Christian gospel before. You've got a great university here, it's attracting people from all over the place. I would be in the freshman dorms like ugly on an ape. I would. I'd give them religion on trial. I wrote it for the non-Christian in mind, 99 pages. That's what I would do. I'd say, and I'll be back. I'll be back in a week to talk to you about it. I'd do random evangelism on campus. I was a product of random evangelism. I just walk up to people and say, hey, you got some time? Have you thought about, you know, what's going to happen when you die? Or have you thought about Jesus Christ? I mean, this thing that you can't do the kind of random evangelism is hogwash. I've got more people I know that I talk to randomly who've become Christians. We just get off our derriere and do some things in that regard. But I'm encouraged. Marcus Zill and the LCMS is really, Marcus came to the academy this summer, and I couldn't be happier. He gets apologetics. He wants to get it. He wants to get it in the colleges, in the freshman dorms, and start integrating it into the high schools. Because frankly, if a kid goes off to college without any armor in apologetics, it's going to be a long, long road.
We are beyond 4 o'clock. So might I, as we head to the fellowship hall, time for fellowship, coffee. We've got various desserts and such. We've got Craig's books that are for sale. Craig will be signing those books as well. Perhaps I will send us that direction with something that the latter half of your presentation made me think of. One of my favorite authors, G.K. Chesterton, who loved fiction. Loved the fairy tale, and I'll butcher the quote, but he said something along the lines of, the great thing, what drew him to the fairy tale was not that because there you find the dragon, but in the fairy tale you learn that the dragon can be defeated.
Yeah.
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 Which is more than just what happens in the fairy tale, but pointing beyond
right.
into the defeat of the dragon by Christ. So,
good deal.
We will see you in the fellowship hall.
Good deal.
Thank you.
Thank you.